Welcome, everyone. I am Angie Larson. I'm the executive minister here at Calvary, and I am so glad that you're here with us today. Today, we're going to continue our worship series that we are calling Inside Out, and we're spending these next couple of weeks in this series talking about all of the emotions that are flooding us right now. Today, we're going to talk about one of the most vulnerable and difficult emotions of all that there is to feel. Joy. That's right, it's joy. Today we are going to take a look at joy and why it's so hard to feel and what Jesus said about joy. So stick around. I can't wait to tell you about it.
Hey folks, Pastor Hans here. I'm the lead pastor here at Calvary, and we are just so honored that you chose to make Calvary a part of your day today as we worship together. In just a few minutes, Pastor Angie is going to continue our worship series. It's called Inside Out. And here's what I know about you and about me. Over the last several months, we've experienced more than our fair share of emotions. We've had COVID, we'd have racial tensions, we've had political divide like we've never experienced before, and we're all experiencing a whole lot of emotions. And so this worship series, Inside Out, we're gonna be exploring what goes on inside each and every one of us, because there's more that goes on inside you than meets the eye. And one of those things, one of those emotions that goes on inside each of us is joy. And over the last several months, some of you felt an absence of joy in your life. But for others, you've experienced an abundance of joy because you've been able to spend more time with your family. Regardless of what it is for you, we believe that we have a God who has something to say about the sort of life God wants for you, the joy-filled life. After Angie's message, we're gonna sing a few songs together, and then you're invited to stick around, especially those of you who are new to Calvary, because we've got some great ways that you can engage in the life of faith through Calvary. And I can't wait to share those with you. Let's worship.
What today's lesson will be about. Today's lesson is going to be about emotions. Now we all start with a primary set, and as we grow older, we acquire more of them.
When your emotions control your actions, it affects not only yourself, but the people around you.
This will help to down.
Emotions are centered in the lower part of the brain.
It is complicated, yes, but mysterious no longer.
Emotional behavior is largely involuntary.
I can't believe that.
We have certain basic emotions which are controlled subconsciously. Notice your own emotional reactions. What did you feel? What did you do?
Under control, your emotions can make you healthier and happier and improve the lives of people around you.
This is pretty clever.
Leader Jack Kornfield writes, "If you can sit quietly after difficult news, if in financial downturns you remain perfectly calm, if you can see your neighbors travel to fantastic places without even a twinge of jealousy, if you can happily eat whatever is put on your plate, if you can fall asleep after a day of running around without a drink or a pill, and if you can always find joy just where you are, then you are probably a dog." I mean, I love dogs. I love how excited they get for just the simplest thing. A walk, a ride in the car, any amount of attention at all. Food, especially if it drops on the floor, and oh, squirrels. They don't worry at all. They just seem to have so much joy all of the time. But for me, joy can be elusive. because there just seems to be so much to worry about. I'm worried about the economy and what that's going to mean for our family's finances. I'm worried about racial injustice in our country and how divided people seem to be over it. I'm worried about the election and how it's going to separate neighbors and friends. I'm worried about COVID. I'm not so much worried about getting sick, but I'm more worried that I'll be a carrier and accidentally give it to someone. So I wear my mask because you never know. And I'm worried about every sniffle or sore throat that my kids get right now. I mean, it's probably allergies, but again, you never know. I'm worried about what we're going to do about school next year and what that's going to look like and how my husband and I will be able to balance our two kids at home, both with full-time jobs. And I'm worried about my kids' mental health having been separated from their regular social times with friends. And I'm worried about their teachers. I'm worried about our college daughter headed back to school in a big city where the population is more dense and viruses seem more rampant. And my car's transmission's going out, so I'm worried that that's going to be expensive. I'm worried my 101-year-old German grandma, Oma, is going to die before I get the chance to see her again. There just seems to be so many things to worry about. Friends, what are you worried about? I mean, let's be honest. These days, it sometimes seems like it's just too much for our tender hearts. What if, though, there is an alternative to worry? What if we can kind of be a little like a dog and just find joy where we are? How do we do that? How do we find joy? For those of you who have had a baby or even like seen a baby, you know that there's just this feeling of deep, unmitigated joy. And you just can't help but stare at them, to just look at them and their perfectness with deep love and gratitude and joy. And sometimes, let's be honest, it can make you overcome with emotion. When I was about 18 weeks pregnant with my third child, I was attending a conference out of town. And luckily, it was in the same city that my Aunt Nancy lived in. And my Aunt Nancy was an ultrasound technician, and I was staying with her while I was at the conference. At the conference, she asked if I wanted to go get some more pictures of the baby, and so I was super excited. And we went to her office and started up the ultrasound machine. As I saw my little one just wiggling around in my belly, I was overcome with joy. I felt like the luckiest person in the whole world. You see, we had lost a pregnancy before this one, and I was overwhelmed with excitement that this baby was in there, the heart beating strong and growing. And my aunt, she printed off these little pictures, and I carried them around, just staring at this little miracle that I had after such deep grief and loss. And the whole next day at the conference, I barely even paid attention. I just looked at these little ultrasound pictures, and I looked at my growing belly, and I felt so much joy. So much excitement for this baby that I had prayed and hoped for this baby that I couldn't wait because I felt so close and it was right there and I could see their face in these little ultrasound pictures. And I couldn't wait to get home from the conference to share these pictures with my husband, Ryan. You know those days when you were just so full of joy that it brings tears to your eyes. Well, this is where I was at. And after the conference was over, I headed out to my car to drive home. And to my big surprise, my Aunt Nancy was sitting on a bench right outside the conference center. And I hadn't expected to see her there. I said, "Hey, what are you doing here?" And she looked at me with this worried expression. And she said, "Angela, sit down." And I sat next to her and she pulled this manila folder out of her purse and she began to tell me. She said, "Angie, when I was doing your ultrasound last night, I noticed something. And so I noticed something didn't look right on the baby. So this morning I took some pictures to our radiologist and my heart began to sink and I could see the worry on her face. She looked at me and she says, "Angie, your child's large and small intestines are developing outside of their body." And it was just like that. And my joy was gone. And worry, it took over. You know the saying, like, you're waiting for the other shoe to drop? It's this phrase that indicates that we expect some kind of negative experience coming. Like something bad has happened, and so we prepare ourselves for another bad thing to come. And we don't want to be caught by surprise, so we mentally kind of game up for it. And I looked up where this phrase came from, and it's from New York City in the late 19th century when apartment living became common. A person would become disturbed and interrupted by someone's shoe dropping in the apartment upstairs. And so they would wait for the other shoe to drop, expecting to be disturbed and bothered again. The next week after I got home, my husband and I went to a doctor after doctor after doctor until we came to a pediatric gastroenterologist, a surgeon. And this doctor told me that this baby would need weekly monitoring for the entire duration of my pregnancy. And they told me that this baby wouldn't go full term and that I would need a C-section and that this baby would need surgery just hours after they were born in order to save its life, in order to repair their gastroschisis, this hole in their belly. They needed to resect the intestines and then gently put them back into this baby's tiny body. When I asked about the amount of things that could go wrong, the amount of things was just astounding, and my worry was all-consuming. The rest of this pregnancy was not one of joy, not for a second, but one of worry, worrying about all the things that could possibly go wrong. And we are warned throughout our lives that things are too good to be true, and we wonder, what if it's not everything I dreamed it would be? We all have this experience where the other shoe has dropped, where we were excited and joyful about something and then something bad happened. And if this happens enough to us, then we're afraid to feel joy almost at all. And friends, this is exactly is why joy is the most vulnerable and most difficult emotion for us to have. Author and researcher Dr. Brené Brown talks about this human experience and what she calls foreboding joy. She writes, joy is actually one of the most vulnerable experiences that we can have as people, because scarcity and fear drive foreboding joy. We're afraid that this feeling won't last, or that there won't be enough, or that the transition to disappointment or whatever's in store for us next will just be too difficult. We've learned that giving into joy is at best just setting ourselves up for disappointment and at worst inviting disaster into our lives. And we struggle with the worthiness issue. Do we deserve joy given our inadequacies and our imperfections? And what about the starving children or the war-ravaged world? Who are we to be joyful? We wonder who we are to be happy, to be entirely overcome with the abundance that the world and that God has to offer us. But one thing that we're actually afraid of, the one thing that is so vulnerable to fear, isn't anger or sadness. The one thing that we feel afraid of is joy. Because if we're honest, our tendency is often to not feel this, to not feel this joy. Our tendency is to just gloss over these moments and catastrophize, to start thinking that the other shoe just might drop at any second. What if this happens or that happens? And we start to worry. And so we dress rehearse all the bad things that could possibly happen, how the bottom could drop out, or how we could be disappointed from this experience. Or we try to protect ourselves from all the things that we think might happen. And friends, God gets this. Jesus understood this, and Jesus understood what it meant to be human, to struggle, to feel deep, vulnerable, messy joy. And God does something about it. So we don't have to catastrophize, and we don't have to worry or push away joy, so that we can just sit and feel it when it comes. It's written in the book of Nehemiah in the Old Testament in the Bible. It says, "The joy of the Lord is our strength." And here's what you need to know, is that God has got this, and you don't need to worry because God is our strength. And it's in the Gospel of John when Jesus was confronting and looking at his own death just coming right around the corner. And he was trying to tell the disciples, and he starts to speak more and more about joy, which is surprising, right? If I was thinking about my upcoming death, for me to even think about talking about joy, I'm not sure what happened, but this is what Jesus does. Jesus says, "Until now you have not asked for anything in my name, but ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be complete." And then again later he says, "But now I am coming to you so that you can speak these things to the world, so that the world may have my joy and be made complete in themselves." So who are you to have joy? You, my friends, you are a child of God. You are a child of God, and you are worthy of joy because the joy of the Lord is your strength. God has got you. It was on October 15th, 2007, that I went for my weekly ultrasound as they looked at this little baby with his insides on the outside. And on my belly, they could see that there was an extra little problem, that his intestines had broken into pieces and then were floating around his little body. And the doctor looked at me gently and said, "Today's the day, Angie." And my husband and I got ready to head into the operating room, and they did the C-section, and they took out my beautiful, beautiful baby boy. Even though his body had struggles and my fear felt like it was on my skin, the joy of looking at my son, the joy of looking at my Sawyer was all-consuming. And I'll be honest, he's almost 13, and it still is. You see, joy is more than pleasure. It's more than a relief from pain or happiness. It's something that comes from within. Something that understands that there is more to the story than this moment right now. It's not denying pain or suffering or the pain and suffering of others, but it's holding on to the ending. It's holding on to the promise that God has got you, knowing that the Lord is your strength. Have you ever skipped ahead in a movie or a book so that you could be reassured that it does have a happy ending while you're reading it? This story has a happy ending. Your life has a happy ending. You see, you can have joy right now because you know the ending. And whether you believe it or not, the story ends where you will embrace your loved ones and you will look upon the face of Jesus. Because of Jesus' resurrection, that is all taken care of. Jesus did this so that you can have life and that you can have joy right now, right here. And you can feel it in its entirety, even though it's vulnerable, even though it's messy, because you, my friends, you know the end of the story. Now, joy, if we pay attention to it, joy isn't something like extraordinary, something like taking your kids to Disneyland. Because let's be honest, it's super fun to see their face when they see Mickey Mouse for the first time. But at the end of the day, when they are crying because you didn't buy them that like $1,000 balloon and your feet are hurting from walking and waiting in line and your wallet is completely empty, it's not really joy, is it? Because joy isn't something extraordinary. It's not something out there that you have to go find or spend money to get. In fact, joy is actually quite ordinary, quite readily available. Like when you're at the lake and it's just a beautiful day and your friends and family are there playing and laughing and you for a second forget your self-consciousness of being in a swimsuit. And then there's this moment, a moment of beautiful joy where you are just overcome with how lucky you are and by how much you love those silly people splashing all around you. Or for me, it's when my kids are home, when my adult kids are in the same space as we are, and we are enjoying time and laughing together and playing a game, just joking back and forth, enjoying a moment of being family. And I'll just sit back and I'll watch my kids all be together, and there's something in my heart that feels so, so full, a lifting up that just brings tears to my eyes. Or sometimes it's just when you're all alone and you have a good book in your hands and no agenda, just joy. Well, I'm going to offer you a challenge for this week, and it's harder than you think because it's vulnerable. I want you to have life, and I want you to have life abundantly. Be fully present in the company of a loved one. Fully taste the ice cream or fully smell the coffee. Care for someone with your whole heart. Stare at the sunset with awe and bask in the fullness of grace that God has given you, letting go of those places in which you feel like you fall short, because that's just a lie. Breathe, exhale, laugh and feel. Have life, have joy, have just so much joy, and really allow yourself to feel it. If you'll please pray with me. God, you fill us with your joy. When we begin to worry or catastrophize, remind us and send people to remind us that you are our strength, that you have got this. Be with those in our community who feel the sadness of this world through grief, through worry, and through loss. Comfort them and send us to comfort them and to walk alongside you. We give you great thanks for the range of emotions that you've given to all of us as we navigate this beautiful world that you have made and our lives with you and with each other. And we know that you are abundantly able to provide more than we ever even dare to ask. And we trust in the work of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The joy of the Lord is is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there is breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you with my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with the glory, Lord of life. I am alive with you. In your presence now I come alive. I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When sorrow comes my way, you are the shield around me. Always you remain like courage in the fight. I hear you call my name, Jesus, I am coming. Walking on the waves, reaching for your life. Yeah.
The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Joy of the Lord.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
The joy
of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Eternity in our hearts. We were yours from the very start. All we've known has been torn apart. Now we have forever. You gave a song for our souls to sing, and your life was an offering. Even death, it has lost its sting.
Take away what the world didn't give. We were made for more. We were made for more. At the end of the day, this will remain. Forever we are yours. Forever we are yours.
You made a place at the table, God. Made the way for the poor. To your open arms, now we have forever.
will remain. Forever we are yours, forever we are yours. No one can take your place. No life nor death can separate. Your love has conquered the grave. Conquered the grave. And you can't take away what the world didn't give. We were made for more. We were made for more. At the end of the day, this will remain. Forever we are yours, forever we are yours. And you can't take away what the world didn't give. We were made for more, we were made for more. At the end of the day, this will remain. Forever we are yours, forever we are yours. Forever we are yours. Divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. As we close out our service, we'll say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hey folks, thanks again for joining us for worship today. We have a few things we want to share with you before we close our time together today. The first is this: if you have young kids at home, we have a few resources we want to share with you. The first is Calvary's Summer Experience for Kids. It's a VBS sort of experience that we're providing to families absolutely free. You can head out to our website, calvaryalec.org, and get signed up for that. Also, this week on the Daily Dose, our evening program at 6:15, both on Facebook as well as on our website, we're going to be talking about sticky faith. How do we pass on a sticky faith to our kids, a faith that sticks? We'd love for you to tune in to that. Here's what else I know. Many of you are missing community. As we've been social distancing and isolating ourselves during this COVID time, we are missing community. And here at Calvary, we believe we can safely gather in small groups, and we call those gatherings watch parties. We want to encourage you to gather with family, with friends, with neighbors, with your connect group, and worship together, watch worship together. And we've got a few resources for you to help with that. We've got a discussion guide out on our website, as well as some instructions if you would like to share communion together with that group that gathers for your watch party. Head out to our website, calvaryalec.org, and find the button that says watch party. There's all kinds of information and guidance there for you. And finally, there are all kinds of things going on in our life of faith. Even though we're not gathering together physically, your church is busier than ever, serving our community, serving those who don't even attend our church. And so I invite you, in order to keep up to date as to what's going on, would you head out to our website and sign up for our email list? I send out a note every week. I'd love to share that with you. Hey folks, as we close today, I just want to say a huge thank you. Thank you for your generosity that allows us to do all that we're doing, even though we're not gathering physically. Every week in our community, we have members of our church that are delivering bags of food to families who are in need. We're helping families through hard times, whether that be through the loss of a loved one or as they go through treatment or medical care. And all of this is possible because of your incredible generosity. So thank you. As we close today, we're going to close with our offering. On the screen, you can see four ways that you can make your gift to our church family. And for your gift, we say thank you. One of those ways is to just simply go out to our website, calvaryalec.org, hit the button that says give. You can make your gift there. You can text the word calvaryalec to 77977, or you can simply drop a check in the mail at the address on the screen. Finally, if you're not quite sure how to make your gift or want some advice or just need some help figuring it out, just feel free to give us a call in the church office. Folks, it's been so great worshiping with you today. Have a great week.